Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody in God's house this morning. What a beautiful day it is as we've come into the Lord's presence, into His sanctuary today to worship and praise His holy name. I'd like to invite each of you to stand with me this morning. We're going to read from God's Word together. So let's please stand as we do this today, as we read from Psalm 128 together. Behold, that thus shall the man be blessed that feareth the Lord. The Lord shall bless thee out of Zion, and thou shalt see the good of Jerusalem all the days of thy life. Yea, thou shalt see thy children's children, and peace upon Israel. Give God a blessing. Praise for the reading of His holy word
this
morning.
Good morning. Happy Father's Day to all the dads. Doesn't the choir look beautiful this morning? Or handsome, I should say. And if you men that would like to join and get in that, come on down. Or come on up. Come on over, however you want to do it. But we're glad to see you in the house of the Lord on this Father's Day as we're here to praise and magnify and worship our mighty and glorious God. We have an awesome Father. He's a good, good Father. I mean, there's none His equal today, and I'm glad I can call Him my Heavenly Father.
Amen.
Amen. Father, we come before Your presence this morning on this great day that we enter into Your house of worship in the name above every name, and that name is the name of Jesus. Hey, I pray today that the Spirit of the Lord will be poured out in this place today. I pray that hearts will be open, receptive, and ready to receive, God, what You want to do in us and through us today. Thank You, Lord, for the men that's in this church, godly men, fathers today. Thank You for families today that love the Lord. Thank You, Lord, for husbands and wives and kids and people that are part of this ministry. And Lord, we are part of the greatest family that's on this earth, and that's the family of God. And we just pray Your blessings today upon each one in this place. Pray, Lord, that Your Spirit will be poured out. Pray that, Lord, You will encourage, lift up. I pray if it's any loss, they'll come to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, God, I pray for those that maybe have drifted and their lives are just not where it should be. I pray today will be the day of coming home, that, Lord, Your arms are open and ready to receive, and You're ready to bless once again. Oh, I just pray Your Spirit will be poured out. And we rebuke every force of evil that would come against us today. I'm glad the Word declares greater is He that is within us than he that is within the world. What a mighty God we serve. The God today that created, the God that's given us salvation, the God today that provides, the God today that has given us and given us a great promise today that one day we shall see Him face to face. All these blessings throughout the pages of Your Word, Lord, we cleave to them and we love them and we thank You for them. And we thank You that, Lord, we have hope. We thank You that we have a God whom we can trust. We're grateful for our Heavenly Father today. I pray Your Spirit will be poured out in this room in such a magnitude today that we will be overwhelmed by the power of the Holy Spirit. Have Your will and Your way in this room, in our hearts, in our lives, in our church. We give all the glory to You. We plead the blood. We name the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus. And Lord, we look forward to what You're going to do. In the blessed, holy, glorious name of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. Isn't He a great God? Yeah. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Searching for answers far and
Designed a master plan. He exchanged the sinner for the sinless one. Jesus left his throne on high, came to earth to bleed and to die. He said, Father, not my will, thine be. His name today. Come on, church. He's a
great. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son. His face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
Mother.
job this morning.
That is fairer than day. And by faith we can see it afar. For our Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. It's in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. It's in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore.
All right, choir's coming down. Shake hands, hug necks. Tell folks you're glad to see them in the house of the Lord. Gentlemen, you may go.
Sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. Oh, in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. Now to our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise for the glorious gift of His love. And the blessings that hallow our days.
Oh, come sing.
It's in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore. It's in the sweet by and by.
We shall meet on that beautiful shore.
Yes,
in the sweet by and by.
We shall meet on that beautiful shore. It's in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore.
All right, you find your way back to your seats. We're going to go back and sing maybe the first verse of this again. But if you can go ahead and get back to your seats, that would be great this morning. And join in this great old song of the faith today, In the Sweet. It's in the sweet by and by. Amen. All right, praise the Lord. Amen. There's a land that is fairer than day.
And by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there.
Come on now.
It's in the sweet.
It's in the sweet by and by.
We shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore.
It's in the sweet by and by.
We shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore.
What a blessing. And Debbie brought this picture of Pete. And this is typical Pete with his Air Force hat. And that look that only he could reflect or give. And we're going to put this up in the ministry. Because I think of the years that he served God in this church. That's the least that we could do in memory of him and the great blessing that he is to us. Amen.
I was walking backwards, away from the light, not realizing how it was right beside me. I walked through the world of sin and shame, blind as can be, not knowing where to go. But the Lord, He showed me where to go, showed me the path to take to make things right. He told me of a place with streets of gold, said to follow Him and I can make things right with the Lord. Thank you. about today to make things right. He told me of a place with streets of gold. Said to follow him and I can make things right with the Lord.
Anyhow, the F in Father stands for faithful. Good fathers are faithful. Good fathers are faithful people. They are first faithful to God and trust God with their whole heart, soul, and mind. Good fathers believe in God's promises that God will preserve their families and that our God, that our good Lord, will provide their families everything needed for salvation. Good fathers accept their role as the spiritual head of the household and set the tone for family worship. Good fathers know God's word. They have an active prayer life, attend church regularly with their families, and obey God's commandments. The A in father stands for action. Good fathers are people of action. Most dads like to watch their sports on television. Some have a few hobbies and engage in some downtime to relax. Despite occasional laziness, good fathers are men of action, especially when their families need them. Good fathers just don't sit there. They spring into action when the toilets overflow, the garbage disposal breaks, or when something important around the house that needs fixing. Good dads know how to get things done. They solve problems and always rise to the occasion. Good fathers also instill a good work ethic in their children and teach by example. Children need to see hardworking fathers, and good fathers challenge their children to learn through activity. Good fathers watch over their children and give them the spaces they need to try new things, learn from the mistake they make. Good fathers are active and engaged parents. The T in father stands for teacher. Good fathers are teachers. Good fathers are teachers and prepare their children to enter adulthood and face the tough world around them. This means that fathers give their children survival skills that they will help transform them into successful adults. Unfortunately, most children do not listen to the advice of their fathers. And we all know that. In order to be good teachers, fathers must be credible and earn their children's trust and love. The H in father stands for hope. Good fathers offer hope to their families. Good fathers are a source of hope and inspiration for their families. Dads are the family pillar of strength, and they are the ones that tell us that things will be all right when tough times are in the corner. Even though dads complain, good fathers are optimistic and resilient because they trust God. Good fathers also trust their children and constantly encourage them to pursue their passions, fulfill their dreams, and plan for the future. Clara Booth Luce once said, "Where there is no faith in the future, there is no power in the present." In contrast, good fathers are forever hopeful and inspire their families to push beyond themselves. The E in father stands for example. Good fathers are a positive example. Good impressions are important, and good fathers are positive role models to their families. Children tend to imitate and adopt their parents' behaviors. Therefore, fathers must be good husbands, live moral lives, and treat all people with respect and dignity. As the home spiritual leader, good fathers take an active part in their children's spiritual development. Finally, the R in father stands for reliable. Good fathers are reliable. Good fathers are reliable, responsible, and consistent. They work hard to bring home the bacon and provide for their family's needs. Good fathers are also helpful in times of crisis. Sadly, many men today are not consistent in their fatherly duties and neglect to see the importance of their role as a father themselves. Fathers need to be reinstated to the level of importance that God has intended them to be.
Okay. Father's Day, over the years, as we grow old, we remember our father, so brave and bold. In the garden, leaning on a plow, he would listen to me. I see him now. He would give advice and understand. He was always there to lend a hand. God made fathers strong and firm, for he knew our lives would have great concern. So he gave us fathers to teach us to pray and guide our lives and show us the way. So on this day, let's take the time to say thanks, Dad. I'm glad you're mine.
My father is such a blessing in so many ways that it's hard to even list them all. The love that he has for God, my mother, Drew and me, other people, and this church is unquestionable, unshakable, astounding, amazing, and absolutely tremendous. My dad is a hardworking man that intensely serves God and his people. He gets up before the rooster crows and goes to bed later than most. He's always on the go but never complains. He's always serving others and putting himself last. He's always there for others in so many ways. I want Dad to know how much he is loved and appreciated. His heart is made of pure gold and the finest diamonds. I know that God is pleased and blessed by Carlton Anderson Duck. I know that Papa and Granny are so pleased and blessed by the man they raised. I know that Mom is pleased and blessed by the man she married. I know that she loves and cherishes him and is so proud of the strong, godly man he continues to be. I know that Drew and I are pleased and blessed by our pastor, mentor, best friend, and Dad. As the saying goes, to the world you are Dad, but to our family you are the world. Oh, I'm not done. I got more. Dad, you're as wise as King Solomon, brave and courageous as Daniel, a servant of Christ as Paul, honorable as King David, persistent and faithful as Job, but most of all, you live, love, and serve like Jesus. I found an acronym that greatly describes my dad. F is for the true friend you are. A, an anchor I can rely on. T, a teacher I can learn from. H, a hero I can look up to. E, a constant source of encouragement. R, a role model I'm proud of. Dad, please know that we love you in an immeasurable amount. You are such a ray of sunshine in our lives. We have so many special memories together, and the three of us have plenty more to make together. The four of us have always been a team and always will be a team. Thank you for being such an amazing pastor, mentor, best friend, and dad to Drew and me. And we have a small gift we had special made just for you, just to show you that we love you. And I didn't have any tissue paper, and it's not from White Barn. It's just the only gift bag I had.
Are you sure?
I'm sure.
Open it already.
I'm trying. I don't want to drop nothing here. Oh, my goodness gracious. We were in Pigeon Forge this is a little stand for it. We went Pigeon Forge, and Cynthia and I, ahead of us, was Drew and Tiff riding a sky lift up to the top of the mountain. Well, we were behind it, so they, being in front of us, turned around and took a picture of us. And if you know anything about Cynthia, she was not a picture-taking person. No, she couldn't jump off of that. And thank God she didn't know what was going on at that time, so she couldn't push me out the car either. So I didn't have nothing to do with it. But what it is, it's on a glass, and it's got a little holder for it, and it's a picture of Cynthia and I riding a sky lift. And naturally, I have to have my mouth open and my hand raised. But nothing new there. But thank you, Tiff. That is so precious. Amen. Love you.
Old man Wrigley lived in that white house down the street where I grew up. Mama used to send me over with things. We struck a friendship up. It's been a few long summers out on his old porch swing. Says he's in the war, was in the Navy. Lost his wife, lost his baby. I broke down and asked him one time, how you keep from going crazy? He said, I'll see my wife and son in just a little while. I asked him what he meant. Looked at me and smiled and said, I raised my hands, bowed my head, finding more and more truth in the words written in red. They tell me that there's more to life than just what I can see.
I can see, I believe.
Couple minutes, and I won't keep you too long, on gospel-driven fatherhood. Now, we had Mother's Day in May. In between Mother's Day and here today is the 17th, and we have Father's Day. But if you'll recall, here several weeks ago, we also inserted a part in also pertaining to children. And so we have basically, over the last few weeks, we've covered mothers, kids, and today we're dealing with the issues of fathers. And you think, well, that's great. You deal with those dads because that means I don't need to listen to this. No, you need to listen to this, whether you're a dad or not, whether you're a male or female or whoever you are, wherever you may be, in what a capacity you may be in, you need to hear the message of God's word, don't you? So we're dealing with, and the good news is today I'm only using one portion of scripture from the book of Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 4. In today's home environment, we have, I believe, what is called a dad deficit. A dad deficit. There's something that is missing in our society and in the rank of our society today, and that is a biblical godly man today that really is a father, a dad, and the things that he should be as God's word describes. Too many kids are growing up without the father influence. They're growing up and they're not feeling the influence, the power, and the help, and the direction, and the leadership they need in their life that only a dad can give. The results then, we find these things then become prevalent in those places, because where there is a lack of a father influence today, then you have poor life choices. And if you look around today in our society, and if you don't believe it, watch the 6 o'clock, 11 o'clock news tonight. Don't watch the 6 o'clock, it's supposed to be in church. Watch 11 o'clock news tonight, and you'll see that there are a lot of people that make bad choices. And that is a result many times because of a lack of father influence. Not only is there bad choices or poor life choices, also there are poor relationships today. I've never seen a day in which we're living in where homes are fractured and falling apart. People get married, they get divorced, they have kids. I mean, it's just a mess. And we're living today in a world that is really fractured. And we see today, and we wonder why the world is in such a condition that it is then, why spiritually our communities are lacking, and why today we're falling apart at the seams. It's because we're falling apart in our homes. We're falling apart in our relationships. So you've got poor life choices, you've got poor relationships, and then you've got poor marriage choices today. Listen, your marriage is important. God did not direct you to a person to marry today, then to turn around a couple years later and check out on them. I believe marriage is important. I believe the first founding foundation that we find in God's word is the home, the relationship, the marriage. So it's important that we have the right relationship today. Fathers, dads today, there are three things that you need to do today that is crucially important. One, you need to listen and learn. If you can't listen, you're never going to learn. A lot of times we want to do all the talking, but really we need to do a lot of the listening too. You need to listen. Well, who do I listen to? Don't listen to the advice of all these bobbing heads that you see on television. Listen to the advice of what God's word has to say. God will never steer you in the wrong direction. He will always give you the right things that you need in order to have value and to have importance and to have an impact in your life that is necessary. You need to listen and you need to learn. You need to learn what God's word says. If you'll apply this book to your life, your home, your family, folks, I'm telling you what, you will have success in God's eyes. Amen. So not only do you listen and learn today, but realize today that you need to spend time with your children. Amen. Come on, y'all. The better you amen, the faster I preach. I thought I'd get something out of you on that. Amen. You need to spend time with your children. Well, I'm just so busy, preacher. You better not be too busy for your kids, your home, and your family. Second, today, you've got to teach them to stand tall. I'm sick of this wimped-out mentality that we've got within our generation and our kids that's coming up today. God didn't raise you up to be a wimp. God raised you up to be a winner. Amen. Amen.
So we need today to teach our children how to stand tall, to be proud. And not only that, but to be a proud American. As far as I'm concerned, as far as the NFL and the NBA and all these other sports things today, if they want to pack their bags, why don't they move to North China? I mean, move to North Korea, they, wherever they want to go. Go somewhere else and go with Dennis Rodman. He'll be glad to have them. I'm sick and tired of sports. I'm sick and tired today of a intentional disrespect for our nation, our country, our military, and our people today that have sacrificed. I believe it's time we stand up and respect that which God has given us. Amen. And then the third thing is we need to give our families, our children, an example. Folks, your kids need to see stability in your life. They don't need to see you falling apart. They need to see you. And if you'll get anchored on the rock of the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll find the stability that you need in your life. So realizing these things today, it's important that we give our kids, our families, we give our communities, and that we give our church the right example. You're not your children's friend. You are their parents. You're their dad, father. And folks, listen today. Give them a godly example of something that they can live by. Let's stand for the reading of God's word. Only one verse, so you'll be up and down quicker than you can bat an eye. Some of you will be up or down before you get back up. Anyway, and ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. Bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. May God bless his word today. You may be seated. We're living in what is called a cultural context today. And further, every book in the Bible, which basically is inspired by God in his word today, is written in a cultural context. Now, stay with me and you'll understand what I'm talking about. To understand what the Bible says, you've got to first interpret the Bible. And if you'll study the word, the Bible says study the word, and today you will understand the word. Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So you will interpret it in the light of the cultural context before you'll try to apply it today to our cultural context. You need to understand God's word. So in our cultural context of 2018 today, Christian fatherhood is probably less appreciated and more vital than it's ever been. People don't appreciate fatherhood. People don't appreciate dads. They've lost the respect. And therefore today, kids, talk to the kids. I've been in public, and I tell you what, and you wonder, hey, wait a minute. I thought it was the dog wagging the tail instead of the tail wagging the dog. You know, kids bossing parents around and having their way. Listen, we've seen moral degradation in our society. We're living in a bad world, and as I told the folks earlier today, you know, we're living in a time and a season that we're very thankful that we're seeing a rise within our economy. We're seeing things that are happening. We're seeing a president that will stand up for what is right and will make the moves and work towards helping the unemployment and working on negotiations with other foreign countries. But let me tell you what, all that said and done, we still are missing the part that is necessary, and that is we're missing the spiritual emphasis that is needful in our country. You just can't build a great country today on economy and politics and foreign relations. You're going to build a great nation. You're going to build a great home. You're going to build a great community on your home and your relationship where God is crowned King and Lord of your life. Amen. And we need to get back to that mentality and not live within this degradation and this sinful environment and the low morals that we're seeing happening in our society today. The question is then this: where are the Christian fathers? Where are the Christian fathers today in our society? Where are the Christian fathers today in our communities? Where are the Christian fathers today in our homes? Where are the Christian fathers today in our churches? Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, where are the Christian fathers today that will anchor their life on the Lord Jesus Christ and be fed on the Word of God? Where are they today? We've got misplaced priorities. Christian fathers who today are doing the hard things and the unpopular things, but standing up for the right thing, amen. And I believe it's necessary. Christian fathers that will secure that gospel, their families with a gospel, and point them to Jesus Christ, amen. You need these things in your life. Your home today will never be built and be successful by accident. It's got to be developed by God through the Word, and Christ has to be the head of your home. As a Christian, we believe that God has revealed himself to us as Father. He is our Father, which art in heaven. Amen. So as Christians, we believe that God has adopted today us as his children. But you know what's so neat about that? We're not treated as adopted children. We're treated as children of God. We are brought into the family as aliens and separated and today apart from God. But God, through his Son, then makes us his children. I'm glad I'm a child of the King. Amen. I'm glad today that we're sons and daughters of the Most High God. And throughout the Bible, he's given us an example and constantly today, and he has written it out for us of today how we can have that relationship with him and that relationship in our homes and that relationship today that will bring blessings of God into our lives. In our text, Paul is writing to the Ephesians, and it's basically what we call a cultural context. So Paul was writing to the new Christian men that was in the community that had families in this small church environment, and they were living in a Greek town. But they had to understand something, that fatherhood is a way today in one way, but Paul in that day, it was one way, but Paul was writing and said, there is a better way. And I'm here to tell you today, there's a better way than what the world is promoting and endorsing. There's a way that is called God's way, amen. I believe the Roman fathers, they had to be the house of the head of the household. And if you know anything about this and know anything about the history of the Roman household, you know that the Roman father had complete dictatorial control. So matter of fact, if they had a child and they didn't like the child, he could take the child up into the barrenness and just leave the child and abandon it with no consequences. As a matter of fact, if the child displeased him, he could take the child and he could sell that child into slavery. Now listen, parents, don't get no ideas. Can't do that. You may have a way with children, but you know what? God can bring them back. And if you don't believe that, read the story about the prodigal son, what he did in that instance. Paul was writing saying that Christ-centered fatherhood is radically and gloriously different. Being a Christian is different than the ways of the world. Your home should be different than the ways of the world. Your home should be different than what your neighbors are doing or your co-workers are doing that has absolutely no inclination and no desire to serve God. You need to build your home on the rock of the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to grab the mentality that Joshua had, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And I'm going to throw another word in there, regardless. Regardless of whether the kids like it or not, regardless of whether it's popular or not, regardless of what your neighbors may say or not, it doesn't make any difference. You are to honor and please God in your home. And when we get back to that, we can see our homes turn back to the power that God wants in the home. Amen. Today we live in a world today that basically is largely has forgotten the unspeakable value of a Christian father. And that's basically today the way it pans out. God is just not looking for a good father. God's looking for a Christian father. Amen. The Christian father is radically distinct today from the fathers of the culture. I hope you are different than what the world is doing. Gentlemen, I hope your standards are higher than the world's standards. I hope your priorities are anchored on this, the Word of God, and centered on Christ, the Savior of your soul. And this is exactly the only way that we are going to see God bless the home once again. Paul gives us a picture today, and he paints it vividly today about the picture of a Christ-like father. See, this today could be a good time for you and I to take an inventory of where we are. Just not the dads, just not the fathers, the kids, the wife. Each of us in this building today, you need to look at your life and see where you are. I mean, your priorities, where are they today? On gaining and getting, but you abandon your kids for that? Your priorities on money instead of the miracle that God's giving you and your family? I mean, today, fathers need to understand today, fatherhood today is a serious thing. It's a responsibility that God has called us to today. And under the lordship of the Lord Jesus Christ, human fathers are to care for their families today as God cares
for his family today. Amen. We need to take care of our families. We need to have spiritual value in our family. We need to have times the day that we are focusing completely and totally on building our homes on Christ, the solid rock. So many homes are failing. So many kids are failing. So many lives are failing. And it's because we have pushed God out of the picture. We no longer want what God wants. We want the conveniences of the world. We've got to have the latest this and the greatest that. And we've got to have all the gadgets and everything else that goes with the world. I mean, you're nothing if you don't have all this. I tell you what, you can have all that. Give me this. Amen. This is what I build my life on. And the one that wrote it is my Heavenly Father. And oh, what a good, good Father he is. Man, I tell you, he supplies my every need according to his riches in glory. He'll wipe away my tears. He'll lift me up. He'll be a friend that will sit closer than a brother. He'll never leave me nor forsake me. He's been an encourager. He's been a lifter. He corrects me when I'm wrong, and he loves me regardless of where I am in life. I'm glad there's never a time that God doesn't love me. There's never a time that God doesn't care for me. There's never a time that God doesn't provide for me. Thank God we have such a Father on our side today. Amen. I have a desire this morning. Listen, I want you to think about this one moment. Your home should be like a little church. Yeah. Did I just electrocute you or something to shock you? You couldn't talk? You couldn't breathe? Your home should be like a little church. Amen. You to know well the conditions of your family. And my desire today in this message over the next couple minutes, I won't keep you too much longer, is to expose you to the truth of the Scriptures, because that's the only thing that's going to set you free. I want you to get this point today. Listen, I just got 2 points in the message. So you can say, what? But I didn't say any sub-points in there, did I? But anyway, I want you to get this point. I want you to get this direction. I want you to get this in your journey. A Christian father always points his children to Christ. Which direction are you pointing your kids? Boy, do the shortcuts, kid. I mean, listen, you can do this and get that. You know, do this and do that. Get this to get that. That's you're directing your children in the wrong direction. If you leave Christ out of your life, your home, your family, your relationship, everything, you've lost the most important component in your living. You need Christ in your home. You need Christ in your life. You need to point your children to Jesus. Amen. So in this message, I'm asking all dads, fathers, godly men, to do this. I want you to commit to these 2 things. Very simple, very profound, but it will change your life. And I pray you'll grasp this today and go with it. One, commit to the joy of your family today. Commit to the joy of your family. Paul said in Ephesians 6 and 4, he said today, basically, you know, we need to embrace this in our homes and our relationships. Don't ever have a desire to see your children. Do you ever see your desire that you want your children filled with joy? So many of us, we just want our kids happy. We just want them so we go get more stuff. And we bring in more stuff. And we get more stuff. And it just, all it does is entertains them, and then sound like Christmas, you know? Kids would rather play with the boxes than that the junk came in, than to play with the junk that you went in debt over to get a whole lot of junk. Within 3 months, it's all broken and laying in the floor and sitting out for the trash. I'm telling you today, the greatest joy they will ever find is in Jesus Christ. That doesn't have a temporary effect. That has an eternal effect. And I've seen parents riding their kids with resentment. This is not God's plan for your life. I've seen parents intimidate their children. Shame on you. Paul said, he said it a little bit different, because if you look at Colossians and Ephesians, it's almost a transparency here. That this is what Paul said in Colossians 3 and 21. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. Anger, discouragement today are 2 states of mind that has become prevalent in the lives of children today. That's going to be completely different than having the joy of the Lord as your strength. Amen. Daughters and sons, learn from their father's example. And it's either going to be a good example or a bad example. I have three directional things today that you can use to help you to set the example today in following Christ. One today, express a clear love today for their mother. Guys, you need to love your wife. You need to love your children's mother, and you need to respect her. Ladies, I thought I'd get an amen out of you. The expression of this love must be today unquestioned. Amen. Cynthia and I were married 46 years. And I'm telling you right now, what an impact she made on my life. And still does, even years later, even after she's gone. Paul gives the Ephesians in chapter 5 and 6, he talks about instructions on how to run your home. See, we abandon that because we say, oh, that stuff about wives submit yourself to husbands, love your wife, all this stuff. That's just a bunch of baloney. That doesn't work. Oh, it doesn't? Well, you're looking at a living example. It does work. Because what that does, it draws you into the priority of what your home is about. It's not about you. It's about Christ in your home. It's about your relationship. It's about respect. It's about love. And it's about the demonstration that you put before your kids. I had that even before I met Cynthia. My parents set that kind of example. Rhonda's parents set that kind of example. And I'm sure many of you had that type of an example set. But even if you didn't have that example, it's no excuse for you today to go flying off and running your home straight into the ground. God can bless your home today if you will let God bless your home. Amen. So Paul said, Ephesians 5:25, husbands, love your wife, even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. So husbands, if you want to know how to love your wife then today and how to treat her today, look to Jesus and see the example that he has for his church. Nobody's ever loved you like Jesus has loved you. No one has ever cared for you like he has. That's your example of how you to love your wife. Man, now listen, you should treat her like she's a princess. Ladies, where are you? Amen, that's good. Guys, listen, you're an example. How are you measuring up? You know, she's the old lady. Oh, really? I tell you right now, if I called Cynthia Duck my old lady, I'd have had a permanent part right down the middle of my head. She was my wife. As a matter of fact, she still is. You've got to display a clear, verbal. Let me ask you a question, guys. I'm going to put you on the spot. How many of you told your wife this morning that you love her? How many of you are lying? Why don't you do it right now? If she's beside you, tell her. Tell her. Lewis, tell her. She's over there. She's still there. All right, just checking. How don't you tell your wife you love her? He knows. He knows. Amen. You need to express that. You need to show that. And you don't need to wait for me to prompt you to do that. Amen. This shows the joy of the Lord in your relationship. Also today, show your sons and your daughters how to treat your spouse. Amen. Show your son how to respect his wife. Amen. And it shows up in your daughters because you know what? You say, well, wait a minute, how about the daughters? What happens with them? It shows them the type of man they should be looking for to marry someday. Amen. Second thing, express a clear love for the gospel. Paul said, bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. So your kids, your family today need to see that your love, you love coming to the house of the Lord. Your family sees you in church. And you know what they see you doing? Surfing the web, texting, checking up on social media, doing Google searches. Oh, I got this new game, preacher. Well, don't play it on my time. And by the way, some of you need to learn to dim your screen when you're doing it in church, because the reflection's in your face. Thank you, Pastor. You're welcome. But you know what I'm doing, preacher. I've got Bible on screen. Oh, I can't believe she said that. I mean, you surfing Facebook and you telling me you're on the Word? Come on. Let me tell you what, folks. Listen, I was playing with you on that. You're here to gain a greater direction for your life, for your family. And you need today to worship the Lord when you're in this place. Amen. You need to come to church, and you need to be seeking God's direction for you, your home, and your family, your children. Your family needs to see a lifestyle today of genuine Christianity, not hypocrisy. Don't be a Christian in church and then go home and you're the biggest hellion on the street. Amen. Then thirdly, express a clear love for your children. You know, this is a love that says, when you're telling your children that you love them, you're telling them that they are important to you. And you've got those children, and you need to love them and bring them up in the right way. So your children will understand God's love if they have been loved by you as their father. Amen. And I'm talking today about a declared love. Well, they know I love them. I'm just not a mushy person. I don't tell people I love them. Well, maybe you need to break out of you and start doing that. Nothing wrong with you hugging your child. Nothing wrong with you hugging your spouse. It's nothing wrong with expressing and showing that love. Amen. Hallelujah. Your children need to hear you love them. Amen. That is a basic need in your life. God declared His love to us. So listen, why don't we declare our love to our children and our families today? These things will, if you're not careful, the things of the world will provoke a resentment or an anger. If you're not loving your child, and if you're not showing that concern and that care for them, they're going to be provoked. And that's exactly what Paul was telling us here. You get provoked today about unreasonableness today. Don't overwhelm your child with too many demands. Don't overwhelm them today. Sure, they got things they need to do, but listen, get off their back. Amen. Stop trying to make your kids be what you want them to be. Give God room to work in their life. Not only that today, but fault finding. I cannot believe you're wearing your hair that way. Those clothes you got on. Well, that's, you know. Kids are always, they don't need to be hearing you beat them up all the time. I know there's standards that they need to meet, and I'm not compromising that. But listen, you need to stop fault finding their lives all the time. Stop picking them apart. Stop destroying them. Stop making them feel substandard. Lift them up and encourage them in the Lord. Amen. Then neglect. You need to spend time with your children. Some of you, you're so work-bound, you cannot spend any time with your kids. Folks, listen, we become so consumed with our stuff, our work, our pleasure. You need to be consumed with your family and have the right example. Then inconsistency. Your family sees today. They see the inconsistencies that's in your life. They see if you're real or you're false. God wants you today to turn away from these things that are destroying your home and your relationship and your family, and start turning to the things today that will build up and strengthen your life today. God, listen, Jesus died on the cross to forgive you. If you messed up the past, thank God, you still have another chance. You can turn things around. Sit down with your family and say, listen, I haven't been the dad, the father that I should have been. I haven't been the example that I should have been. My language has not been the language it should have been. My example has not been the example it should have been. My conduct has not been the example that it should have been. I have not loved you and your family the way that I should have. Forgive me. I want to start over, and I want to show you that I'm genuine. I'm real. I love God, and I want you to know that I love you. Amen. Come on, be honest with your family. Admit if you've messed it up.
But thank God, God can turn it around when you come to the end of you. You're not Superman, I'm sorry. You should be a godly man that loves the Lord. Commit to the joy of your family. And the second one is this, and I'll make this short and sweet. Commit to the future of your family today. Bring them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. So what does Paul say here? Bring them up in the nurture. That nurture is interpreted meaning discipline. Now, what I've said before doesn't mean today that your house is a permissive society, that anything goes. There has to be standards, there has to be rules, and you've got to maintain those. If you violate those, there's punishment that goes with that. Kind of like that commercial. You seen that commercial about the kid? He walks in the bedroom, his parents are sitting in the bed. Oh, that thing is classic. Amen. Yeah. Oh, there was a slight accident in the drive-in thing. And then going all through. No keys for 6 weeks, whatever. Thank you, we're good. And I've learned to learn something. That's, yeah. I love that commercial. Amen. You know why that kid's talking that way? Because he's been taught to talk that way. Folks, listen. You need to be consistent with your kids. You need today to set the right example. You need to invest in their lives today that they can be the best that they can be for Christ. Bring them up. If there's a need for discipline, you cannot let the kids run the house. Amen. Kids need to know there's a difference between right and wrong. Kids need to know that discipline brings wisdom, because Proverbs 19 says, chasten or discipline your son, for there is hope. So you've got to have that element of discipline today. The Hebrew writer says, chastening yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness. So the last thing that Paul points out is admonition of the Lord, which is the instruction of God. Are you instructing your kids, your family, in the things of God? Well, we just kind of do our own thing. We get to the table and everybody's got the cell phone. We check in social media, answering emails, doing all those great things. You need to take that phone and put it in the drawer when you're at the table. And I don't care if you're eating out or eating in the house. Turn it off. You can get by 15 minutes without social media. Spend time with your family. Talk to your kids. Talk to your wife. Talk to your husband. Communicate. So, your living room is like this. TV's blaring. She's over there. You over here. You got one. She's got one. Kids in the room. They in there wearing the thumbs out. Getting carpal tunnel with video games. So, you would like to have a glass of water. So, rather than getting off of your... You sit there. Oh, yeah. I can't do it with one thumb. I'm good with one. That's about all I can do. Hi, honey. Do you think you could get me a glass of water? You sit there. Sure, sweetie. Put it away. You got one? Use it. Talk. Communicate. That's why we're in such a mess in our homes, in our families, in our lives. We don't talk. We don't tell people we care. We don't tell people we love them. We don't care people they're important to us. I'm talking about your family. It galls me when I go out to restaurants and I see couples sitting at a table. She's going on hers and he's going on his. Man, Lord have mercy. Hello, put the stupid phone away. And I'm telling you today, put your stupid phone away. Amen. Maybe we need to go back. Oh, I got a text. I don't think so, Gloria. Hey, Gloria, here you go. She wanted some water. Christian's parents need to be different than worldly parents. We don't need just nice and respectable children today. Carpet got a good washing too. Let me wrap it up here for you. Being right is going to cost you something. And you got to start standing up for what is right and doing what is right. Today is time, I believe today, that we start turning from sin, turning from the world, and start turning to Christ. I believe it's time we start getting our homes and our families back on the altars of God. I believe it's time that we restore our relationships. I believe it's time that we start expressing that love that we have in our families and telling each other that we love each other. I believe it's time today that we commit to the joy that we can have in our families, and I believe it's time to commit to the future that God has for our family. And that's only found in one, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. If you don't know him as your personal Savior today, will you come to him? If your home today needs prayer, why don't you bring it to the altar? Today, if God has blessed your home, you ought to come and thank God for it. It's time we get back to the altars of God, get our families and our relationships right with God, and start being the godly fathers and dads that God has called us to be. This is not an option. It is a command of God. Father, right now as we stand to our feet, we pray in Jesus' name. I don't know what need may exist in hearts and lives of people today, but I do know today that, God, you can meet every need of every heart and every life. I pray right now that you will draw us to altars, altars of repentance, altars of repair, altars of blessings, altars of redemption. I pray that, God, right now, as the invitation begins with this song, God, I pray you'll draw us to altars of prayer to call upon a righteous and holy God that will make such an awesome difference in our life. We plead your blood. We call upon your name. We seek your face.